فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Ibn Taymiyyah used to say, بالصبر واليقين تنال الإمامة في الدين. Patience and certainty, through it you're going to attain leadership. Ahmed became an imam. When did he become an imam? When he showed patience, sabr. Okay, and let's asbir inshallah. And he showed yaqeen, certainty. For what? أن العاقبة للمتقين. The final ending are for the muttaqeen. As long as I come with taqwa, Allah is going to give me the final abode and the final ending. And that's what Ahmed rahimahullah. فالصبر, Imam Muhammad was patient. Patient upon what? The jahmiyyah and the hardship that they threw, put him through. That today, the jahmiyyah are mentioned in a good light or a bad light. Anyone who talks about Jahmiyyah Safwan, يَذُمُّ وَيُقَبِّحُهُ. Yeah? Rather, the takfir of the jahmiyyah had become ijma'. In عقد الإجماع, the consensus of the Muslims, قَرْنًا بَعْدَ قَرْنٍ, generation after generation, it came. But what was it? It was one time a belief. It was a belief system. People were believing in that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed that fitna. Allah gave the upper hand to the Muslims. And Imam Muhammad, the leader, came and took him out of the Wathiq. He came, and what did Wathiq do? He said to Ahmed, come out. He took the chains off Ahmed himself and said, you are free. You can do what you wish. And he said to Ahmed, I'm going to give you money and everything. Ahmed said, I don't want it. He said, I'm going to give you dunya, houses, and he said, I don't want it. He said, we're going to build your house and everything. No, he said, I don't want it. I want to go back to where I was. And I just want to teach in my halaqah that I used to teach in. Sah? That's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him in this world. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. When this time went by, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a group of people came out after Ahmed ibn Hanbal, Al-Imam al-Bukhari, Al-Imam Abu Dawood, Al-Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Al-Nasa'i, and others came out calling to the Tawheed, Al-Aqeedah, writing books. Sunnah was spreading. Then came مَا لَا قِبَلَ لِأَحَدٍ بِهِمْ, a people who no one could stop. And they were a junood from the junood of Iblis. Wallahi. They were opposing the Rusul and the message of the prophets. And they were fighting against the Qur'an and the Sunnah in its true essence. They were fighting it. بِعُقُولِهِمْ, based on their logics. وَآرَائِهِمْ, and their views and their opinions. And they are the قَرَامِدَةُ الْبَاطِنِيَّةِ الْمَلَاحِدَةِ, the قَرَامِطَة, or a deviated group. الْبَاطِنِيَّةِ, who believe that the Qur'an has an internal meaning that no one understands. There's a batin meaning in the Qur'an. When Allah is saying this, that's what you guys can see. But there's something else that's hidden in there. The secrets in the Qur'an that only a group of people know. This is hadmul Islam, to destroy Islam. And their slogan was al-aqlu, that the logic muqaddamun ani naqli, that the aql and the logic and the rationality takes precedence over the textual evidences. And they used to say to the people, you guys are naql, we leave textual evidence with you guys and we will take the aql. That's what they would say. And these people brought about chaos to this earth. They brought chaos. They brought to Islam and the Muslims that which even the previous ones didn't bring about. They killed the leaders, the Muslim leaders. They even killed the Hujjaj, the people who were doing Hajj. They killed them one person after the other. They threw them all in the wells of Mecca. They poured them all in there. And they sat in Mecca, in the gates of Mecca, when the person enters Hudud al-Haram. They were waiting for the people, the Hujjaj that are coming, slaughtering and killing them. They took the black stone, وَقَالَعُ الْحَجَرِ الْأَسْوَدِ, they took the black stone from its place and they took it to their own land. They kept the black stone for a very long period of time. You see? And they became arrogant, a tyrant. But because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He brought to them poverty, hunger, winds. Allah brought them natural disasters. So the leader said, you know what? I think the reason why we're getting this natural disaster is because we got the Hajar al-Aswad. Let's just take it back. So they brought back the Hajar al-Aswad. And when they brought the Hajar al-Aswad, the ulama of that time was asked, How do we know what they brought back is the Hajar al-Aswad? How do we know that what they brought back is a black stone? What about if they just brought a black stone and not the black stone? So the scholars of that time said, the black stone doesn't sink if you put it in water. It won't sink, it will float, come up on the surface. So they said put it in water, and so they put it in water and it didn't sink. The black stone goes on the top surface. So they took the black stone and they put it back in its place when they realized it is the black stone they brought back. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He destroyed them. Then came out a group, so they got destroyed in where they were. Another group of theirs kind of came out in Al-Maghrib, you know, with a bit of strength here and there. Then they went to Egypt, they took over Egypt. And books then were started to be authored, like Ikhwan al-Safa, Isharat, the Shifa, Umri Sina. All of those books started to come out which had kufriyat and stuff like that in it. The Muslims started to read that stuff. Ya ikhwati al-kiram, the matter carried on until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he brought the Imam al-Da'wah. Imam al-Da'wah, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. When an Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab came, just before him came Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah and others. Ibn Taymiyyah fought with these opinions now. And if you have to realize, at the time Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah came, the opinions of all of the groups were now written. It was documented. The works are out there. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah took the pen and paper. And what he did was he destroyed these principles from his foundations. Bit by bit. Rahimahullah. And Muhammad and Ibn Taymiyyah, for the first time, you see, was able to destroy logic through the textual evidences, the Kitab and the Sunnah. And he broke it and dismantled it. بحجج والبراهين, evidences and proofs from the Quran. Then groups started to come out at the time of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, but he smashed their heads. And so they used to benefit from the times he would go to prison. The times that Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah would go to prison was the best time for them. The reason is because when Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah was in prison, it meant that they could author their works, they could spread their misguidance, and that's what they would do. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He brought al-Imam al-Mujaddid Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, and he called to that which the prophets called to. He called to Tawheed al-Ibadah, the worshipping of Allah alone, not associating partners with Him. He went against the Tawassul al-Mubtadi', that this Tawassul of going through the Prophet ﷺ, his honor and his jah. He also fought against the issue and the concept of Shaddur Rihal, traveling to the graves. That no one is allowed to travel to anything other than the three masjids. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Muhammad Abdul Wahhab. He also fought against the concept of building upon the graves. That's what he fought against. He also worked on Allah, honoring Allah's name, subhanahu wa ta'ala's attributes. He fought against innovation that were newly invented in the religion. And what he also did was he left beneficial knowledge. But the different thing between Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah was that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab had something else extra that even Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim didn't have. And that was, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab had Sayfun Yansur. He had a sword that was going with his hujjaj. He had a government that was pushing his belief. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him and helped his da'wah spread through none other than, and also a mujaddid of his time, Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah, imam, haqqan, who told Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, educate, teach the people the Tawheed and the Sunnah, and I promise you it will manifest. Because he was a leader of Dir'iyya that the Shaykh rahimahullah was at. And because of that, Nasharat Tawheed spread. وَلِذَلِكَ شَيْخُ الْإِسْلَامِ حَمْدٍ عَبْدُ الْوَهَابِ. It would be very nice, my beloved brothers and sisters, to look at the dialogue and the conversation that went between him and Muhammad ibn Sa'ud. Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, because remember, when Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab got kicked out, where did he come to? He came to Dir'iyya, scared, worried, and no one. Who heard of him? The wife of Muhammad ibn Sa'ud. His wife knew that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab came, and she knew of him. She took, his works and his stuff had reached her. So she went to Muhammad ibn Sa'ud and she said, an honorable man has now come into your city. And that's how a wife can play her role. She said to him, today is a time Allah can honor us in this world by allowing this man's the truth and that which he's coming with. Are you with me? So Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, he said to him, okay. She said, don't let him come to you. Go to him. Allahu Akbar. Don't let him come and visit you in your house. You go to him. Let him see that you're honoring him. Muhammad ibn Sa'ud is the chief leader of the tribe of the people of Dir'iya. He got on his riding beast and he went to Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. And he sat with him. And Muhammad ibn Abdul, look at this. Wallahi billahi alaykum. He said to Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, after Muhammad ibn Abdul put his proposal forward, Muhammad ibn Sa'ud said, I will give you victory with conditions. I will help you with conditions. He said, what is it? Number one, you're not allowed to leave us. You're not allowed to go from us. You have to stay with us. You have to be part of us. Muhammad ibn Abdul said, I agree to that. He said, second thing is, there's a tax that I take from the people. There's a tax that I take from the people. I don't want you to stop me from that. Wallah, he didn't do mujamala. He didn't lie and deceive him and say, no problem, take it if you want. Bit by bit, I'll take. La, he said, haram. Muhammad is wrong. The money that you're taking is incorrect. But I promise you one thing, Allah is going to give you a better iwad, something better than what you're looking for. But give victory to the Tawheed and the Sunnah. La mujamala. No lying to a person, telling the people the truth, what is right. And when he saw how direct Muhammad was, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab, and how he didn't, he could have said, don't worry, we'll share that money, well, none of that. He said, okay. And they both stood up together and tilted. Today, مشارق الأرض ومغاربها, their efforts are being reaped and their hard work. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honor them and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow His never-ending mercy on them. So this is how there was always that battle between the sunnah and innovation and the causes of istiraq and disunity and what was causing it. القاعدة الثانية عشرة, the 12th قاعدة. The 12th qa'ida is أنهم, that they are يعتقدون أهل السنة والجماعة believe أن البيعة الشرعية, that the legislated pledge of allegiance لا تكون إلا لإمام مسلم, it cannot be except for a Muslim leader. أهل السنة والجماعة believe that the only individual who pledge of allegiance can be given to is إمام مسلم, a Muslim leader. بايعه أهل الحل والعقد, that pledge of allegiance is given to him through who? Ahlul Halli wal Aqd. Wal Aamatu Taba'un Lahum. And the general mass are followers of the Ahlul Halli wal Aqd. Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe, are you there? That pledge of allegiance is not given except to a Muslim leader. Who is the one who gives it to the Muslim leader? A group of people who are known as Ahlul Halli wal Aqd. That's it. The rest of the people, they follow Ahlul Halli wal Aqd. Ahlul Halli wal Aqd are the chief members of the tribe. And they are the scholars. You see? And they are the people who have authority, some form of power amongst the people. They are called Ahlul Halli. Ahlul Halli wal Aqd. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, those of you who believe, ati'u Allah, obey Allah, wa ati'u Rasulah, and obey the Messenger. وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, and obey those who have authority over you. So the Prophet ﷺ commanded us in this verse that we obey those who have authority over us. The Muslim leader, we obey him. Anas ibn Malik narrated in a hadith which you will find in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, that the Prophet said, اسمعوا وأطيعوا, listen and obey. وَإِنِ اسْتُعْمِلَ عَلَيْكُمْ عَبْدٌ حَبَشِي, even if it's an Abyssinian leader that's placed over you. مَا أَقَامَ فِيكُمْ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ, as long as he establishes the book of Allah on you. Abi Hurairah narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, كانت بني إسرائيل تسوسهم أنبياؤهم, that the people of Banu Israel, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Banu Israel, the ones that used to run their affairs was their prophets. Banu Israel, they were run and they were governed by their prophets. كُلَّمَا هَلَكَ نَبِيٌ خَلَفَهُ نَبِيٌ, every time a prophet died, Allah will bring about another prophet. وَإِنَّهُ لَا نَبِيَّ بَعْدِي. There is no prophet after me. وَسَتَكُونُ خُلَفَاءَ فَتَكْثُرُ. And there's going to be many leaders. They're going to be large in number. There's going to be a lot of Muslim leaders. There's not going to be one leader that governs the whole Muslim world. It won't happen anymore. It's going to be أَقْطَارَ الْقُطُرُ. Little lands. Something like that's going to happen. The companions, they said, فَمَا تَأْمُرُنَا. What do you command us when that happens? قَالَ. Then the Prophet said, The prophet says, فَوَا بَيْعَةَ الْأَوَّلِ فَالْأَوَّلِ. Give pledge of allegiance to one after the other. وَأَعْطُوهُمْ حَقَّهُمْ. And give them their rights. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ سَائِلُهُمْ عَمَّا اسْتَرْعَاهُمْ. Allah is going to ask them the day of judgment in that which they were made leaders over. Meaning, if they don't give you your rights, forget it. Allah is going to question them for it. But you give them their rights. You give them their rights. The Prophet ﷺ also said in the hadith of Adi ibn Hatim, قُلْنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. We said, O Messenger of Allah, لَا نَسْأَلُكَ عَنْ طَاعَةٍ مَنْ اتَّقَى وَلَكِنْ مَنْ فَعَلَ وَفَعَلَ. The Sahabas, they said, Ya Rasool Allah, we're not going to ask you about obeying the one who is doing good. The Muslim leader that's doing good, we're not going to ask you about obeying him. But we're going to ask you about the one who does this, and he does this, and he does this. And so they mentioned many evil things. Then the Prophet said, اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ فِيَ اللَّهَ وَاسْمَعُوا وَاطِعُوا. Just listen and obey. Ah. So we're already told that there are going to come leaders that are bad. Can the Prophet go even worse by saying to us, he went so far as much as saying, the Prophet said to us, قُلُوبُهُمْ قُلُوبُ الذِّئَابِ فِي جِثْمَانِ الْإِنسِ. They are so evil, their hearts are the hearts of wolves. And they are in the form of a human being. Can somebody be worse than that? That's how bad these people are. They are, the Prophet saying this, the leaders are going to come, and these leaders are going to be what? Their hearts are wolves. Wolves. Hayye. And they're going to look like human beings. They've got human bodies. But they have no rahmah for their people. Look at what Bashar is doing to his people. Does he have any rahmah towards his people? Kills them. Massacre has the women and the children. The Prophet already told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, that's what's going to happen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he said, on the hadith of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, man arada bahbuhat al-jannah, anyone who wants to go, bahbuha means a wasat al-jannah, anyone who wants to go in the middle of Jannah, he wants to be in the middle, not on the sides or the corner of, he wants to make it right into Jannah. Fa'alihi bil jama'ah, stay with the jama'ah. And we took yesterday, what's the jama'ah? A people who are upon al-aqidat sahiha. And then when tanazu happens, difference of opinion, they take it back to the kitab and the sunnah, and al-imam al-mubaya', and a Muslim leader who's given bay'ah. We said that yesterday, those are three. I mentioned that yesterday. That's what the word jama'ah means. So fa'alihi bil jama'ah, stay and stick with the jama'ah. Fa'inna ash-shaytana ma'al wahid, because shaytan is with one. وَهُوَ مِنَ الْإِثْنَيْنِ أَبْعَدْ. And shaytan is far further from what? Two people. You see? So in other words, stick with the Muslim. Don't disconnect from them and become your own empire and your own khilafah. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, he said that the Prophet said, السَّمْعُ وَطَاعَ. Listen and obey. عَلَى الْمَرْءِ الْمُسْلِمِ. On a Muslim person. فِيمَا أَحَبَّ وَكَرِي. Listen in that which you like. Listen to him when he says something you like. And listen to him when he tells you something you dislike. Listen to him. مَا لَمْ يَأْمُرْ بِمَعْصِيَةٍ. As long as he doesn't command you that which is disobedience. فَإِذَا أَمَرَ بِمَعْصِيَةٍ. If he commands you disobedience, فَلَا سَمْعَ وَلَا طَاعَ. Then there's no obedience and there's no listening. But some people say, ah, you see, if he tells us to do something wrong, we no longer have to obey him anymore. No, the Prophet means just that thing. Just that thing. If he tells you after that to do something else, you have to listen. Because there are other narrations that mention that. So from the manhaj of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah is that they believe that the bay'ah is given to a Muslim leader. It is the concept of the Khawarij to have a hizb, a group who have bay'ah under the Muslim leader. Sah? Are you with me? Ikhwan al-Muslimin, Hizb al-Tahrir, they live in Muslim countries, right? They have their own bay'ah for their own group. And then who are they giving bay'ah to? The leader of the group. When there is a Muslim leader above them and in charge of their affairs. Are you with me, brothers? There is a Muslim leader above them that they have given bay'ah to. But what have they done? They've taken their hand out from that Muslim leader and they've given it to the person in charge of their group. That's khiyana. That's deception. You see, this is for who? For the people of the Muslims to give bay'ah to them and stick with him. القاعدة الثالثة عشرة. The 13th قاعدة. أنهم لا يرون الخروج على الولاة الظلمة والفسقة بل يذمون ذلك ويذمون من خرج على الولاة دينا ودنيا. The 13th قاعدة is that they don't go against the Muslim leader. No, they don't. أنهم لا يرون, they don't see, أهل السنة don't see, going against the oppressive Muslim leader. This is عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة. It's an عقيدة related issue. أنهم لا يرون الخروج. They do not see permissible to go against a Muslim leader, even if he's oppressive, even if he's a fasiq, he's doing major sins. بل يذمون ذلك. He drinks khamar. This leader is drunk. He's an alcoholic. He comes on television. He's drunk. They still obey him and they still listen to him. They're still under him. He's a well-known zani, committing zina on the regular. He comes to the UK and he goes and he brings a prostitute to his hotel. He's known to do that. It's well known, established. Al-Sunnah still don't go against him. إِنَّهُمْ لَا يَرَوْنَ الْخُرُوجَ عَلَى الْوُلَاةِ الظَّلَمَةِ. He's oppressive, he's killing the Muslims. It's bloodshed. He's taking people unjustly, he's arresting them. He's putting them in prison. He's killing the people. لَا يَرَوْنَ الْخُرُوجَ. They don't see the permissibility of going against him. Rather, if anyone goes against them, they rebuke him and they scold him and they refute him. وَيَذُمُّونَ مَنْ خَرَجَ عَلَى الْوُلَاةِ. Whether the reason you're going against him is a religious related reason or whether it's a worldly related reason. And Imam Ahmed in prison, I told you, did he not get imprisoned? Did Mu'tasim not arrest him? Did Imam Ahmed not get lashed? Imam Ahmed, when they took the chains off him, they took the chains off Imam Ahmed, what did he say? And Imam Ahmed, when they took the chains off him, he said, if the leader just let me free like this, I would not have gone from the prison cell. I would not have walked away. If you just let this take this chain off me, I will not run away. I won't go nowhere. I will listen to him. Are you with me, brothers? I will still obey him and I will still listen. هذا إمام أهل السنة والجماعة. What is it that leader said? What is it the leader said, brothers? He said the Quran is makhluk. That's what they're fighting for. Is that statement not kufr? That is kufr بإجماع العلماء. It was consensus that it was kufr. مع ذلك إمام أحمد, he used to make dua for the leader. He used to make dua for him. اللهم اهديه. Oh Allah, guide him. Oh Allah, he used to say Imam Ahmed رحمه الله تعالى. So nowadays we find people who say to you, أخي, look, they'll send you clips, videos of the Muslim leader drinking alcohol, for example, doing this or that, whatever it may be. Allah أعلم whether we can even trust those stuff. It can be edited. But the point is, even if he is, then what do you want? Why are you doing this for? Why are you spreading this? Do you want the Muslims to go against him? Is that what you want? And cause chaos and catastrophe on this earth? Is that what you want? Some people today would want, for example, على سبيل تمثيل الحصر. As this example, they would want the Saudi government to collapse. They say, what do you want us to do? Not go Hajj al-Umrah? Do you want to change Saudi Arabia into like Syria, like how it is right now? Is that what you want to bring about? Is that the trials and the tribulation, the fitan you want to bring to the people? That the loads to Mecca and Medina closes? Ya akhi, how many students of knowledge are coming up from Jamia Islamiyah every single year? From all over the world. How many masahif are being published for the Quran? Books of knowledge are being published over there? How many ulama are authoring? Once that fitna happens, the scholars are all going to scatter all over the place. Disperse, and those scholars will die with their knowledge because they can't teach anymore. One of the things that we encountered in our country in Somalia is that when the fall of our country and chaos and fighting and consistent battles, the mashayikh, one of the things I asked him was, Sheikh, how's the lessons? He's like, we can't have a lesson for years. When we start, a fight kicks off, the sheikh has to run away, students all disperse, those books are stopped now. And then he's got new students. And then another fight kicks off. And then what? He's never able to have students for the next 30, 20 years teach them so much sciences. He can't. He dies with his knowledge. So much of those ulama are in other countries in the world now. They're not even in their own country. They can't live there because of what? Because of fear for their lives. Has that not brought about bad? Has it not? This is what it brings. So this is what these people want. But Allah exposed them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the so-called Arab Spring they call. Allah exposed many of them. Allah exposed them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, calling the people to uprise against their leaders. But what did they bring about? What did they say? What happened? We didn't see no spring. We saw hellfire. We saw adab. Wallahi, look at Syria now and look how it was before. And Dima, brothers, wallahi, this is not a joke. Thousands, hundreds of thousands of innocent kids are killed. If people looked back at it, would they have preferred that things were stability? Naam. Syria had one of the biggest makatib in the Muslim world, Maktabat al-Dahiriya. Where is it all now? Do you guys know where it's ended? One of the biggest makatib in the Muslim world. One of the biggest madaris was opened there. Madrasat al-Umariya was there. From Syria, the ulama came from it. Ibn Abdul Hadi, rahimahullah, and Abul Hajjaj al-Mizzi, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah. These ulama came from it. Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, Abu Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudam al-Maqdisi, Diyauddin al-Maqdisi. These ulama came from Syria. Look what's happened today. The Prophet said to us, alayhi salatu wasalam, in the hadith Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that the Prophet said, سَيَكُونُ بَعْدِ أُمَرَىٰ, after me are going to come leaders. فَتَعْرِفُونَ مِنْهُمْ وَتُنْكِرُونَ. You're going to see leaders. They're going to bring about things that you will recognize and you will be in agreement with, and they're going to come with things that you're not going to be agreement with, things that you're going to disagree with. فَمَنْ أَنْكَرَ فَقَدْ بَرِي. Anyone who disagrees with them will be what? He will be safe. وَمَنْ كَرِهَ sorry. وَمَنْ أَنْكَرَ فَقَدْ بَرِئَ. He will be buried, free from it. وَمَنْ كَرِهَ فَقَدْ سَلِمْ. And the one who shows disagreement will be safe. وَلَكِنْ مَنْ رَضِيَ وَتَابَعْ. But the one who is pleased with their evil and follows them in it, he's got problems. Then the Sahaba says, أَفَلَا نُنَابِذْهُمْ بِالسَّيْفِ. When they come with that evil, shouldn't we shither our swords? Shouldn't we go out and slice their throats? Should we kill those leaders then, who are bringing evil to the earth? The Prophet said, لا. No. مَا أَقَامُوا فِيكُمُ الصَّلَةِ. As long as they are praying. And the reason why the Prophet said as long as they're praying, meaning as long as they are Muslims. So as long as they're Muslims. Because Islam is, the Salah is the significance of Islam. Look what the Prophet ﷺ said. سَيَكُونُ in Hadith Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman رضي الله تعالى عنه. He said, يَكُونُ بَعْدِ أَيْمَةُ لَا يَهْتَدُونَ بِهَدِي. They are going to come leaders that will not be guided upon my guidance. They won't take that as a guidance. وَلَا يَسْتَنُّونَ بِسُنَّتِي. And they won't stick to my sunnah. وَسَيَكُونُ فِيكُمْ رِجَالٌ قُلُوبٌ قُلُوبُ الشَّيَاطِينَ فِي جِثْمَانِ إِنْسٍ. Their hearts are the hearts of shaitan, and they are in the body of humans. حُذَيْفَ said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ كَيْفَ أَصْنَعُ إِنْ أَدْرَكْتُ ذَلِكَ. What shall I do if I reach that time? The Prophet said, تَسْمَعْ وَتُطِيعْ. You're going to listen and you're going to obey that leader. وَإِنْ ضَرَبَ ظَهْرَكْ وَأَخَذَ مَالِكْ فَاسْمَعْ وَأَطِعْ. Even if he lashes your back, he takes your wealth, listen and obey. Ya akhi, he's beating you. He's taking your money unjustly. Listen to him and obey him. Al-Imam Muslim narrated it. لكن والله أهل الأهواء. People of desires. أهل الأهواء. People of desires, what are they going to do? These ahadith, because it's against them, what are they going to try to do? يضعفونه. So they try to weaken a hadith in Sahih Muslim. They try to weaken a hadith in Sahih Muslim. The Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ أَتَاكُمْ وَأَمْرُكُمْ جَمِيعٌ عَلَى رَجُلٍ وَاحِدٍ. Anybody who comes, pay attention to you, anyone who comes. This hadith is Arfajat al-Ajja'i radiallahu ta'ala anhu. That the Prophet said, if anyone comes to you and you're united under a leader, يُرِيدُ أَن يَشِقَ عَصَاكُمْ, and he wants to disunite you and break your unity, وَيُفَرِّقَ جَمَعَتَكُمْ, فَاقْتُلُوهُ, kill him. Fight with that individual who wants to break the Jew. So this country, Saudi Arabia, for example, they got their leader. They got their everything running smoothly for them. Anyone who tries to come and tries to bring any conflict between them and the leader and tries to disunite them from it, the Prophet commanded them, فَقْتُلُوهُ, kill that person. كَائِنًا مَنْ كَانَ, whoever that person may be. كَائِنًا مَنْ كَانَ, whoever that person may be. Nafi' said, who was a Mawla Abdullah ibn Umar, when the people of Medina, they took away their bay'ah from Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Some of the people of Medina, they took away their bay'ah from Yazid ibn Muawiyah. They didn't like who he was and what he was doing and what reached them regarding his affairs. So they took away their bay'ah from him. Abdullah ibn Umar told them to all come. He gathered them all and his children. Even his children, when they wanted to take their hands back. They didn't want to carry on their pledge of allegiance. Abdullah ibn Umar told them, all of them, come. When they came to him, he said to them, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, يُنصَبُ لِكُلِّ غَادِرِ اللِّوَاءُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. The deceitful person, the day of judgment, a banner will be placed for him. And on that banner it will be said, this is a deceitful person. That's what we say. وَإِنَّا قَدْ بَايَعْنَا هَذَا الرَّجُلِ. This man Yazid ibn Muawiyah, we gave him our words. We gave him bay'ah. عَلَى بَيْعَةِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. We gave him pledge of allegiance based on Allah and His Messenger. وَإِنِّي لَا أَعْلَمُ غَدَرًا أَعْظَمْ. I don't know any deception greater من أن يبايع الرجل, that a person gives a bay'ah on Allah and His Messenger. ثُمَّ يُنصَبُ لَهُ الْقِتَالِ. And then he goes against him to fight him. وَإِنِّي لَا أَعْلَمُ أَحَدًا مِنْكُمْ خَلَعَهُ وَلَا تَابَعَ فِي هَذَا الْأَمْرِ إِلَّا كَانَتِ الْفَيْصَلُ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَهُ. And I don't know any one of you who has chosen to do that, except this is where me and you disperse and we leave each other. In other words, I have nothing to do with you anymore. And Imam al-Bukhari narrated this. وَلِذَلِكَ Imam Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said something very powerful. Very, very powerful. A statement that deserves to be written in ink of gold. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, those who went against the Muslim leader, he said, they did not bring about the religion that they were looking for, nor did they bring about any worldly gain. They didn't bring about any religious rulings, or they didn't bring about any Islamic joyful, anything Islamically somebody can be joyful about, and they didn't what? Bring about any worldly gain. Are you with me, brothers? And you know what some people's concepts are like? Some people's belief is ابن قصرا وهد مصرا. Build a building and destroy the whole of Egypt. That's their concept. Build one building in Egypt, but don't worry about it. The whole of Egypt. Destroy if it has to be. That's their belief and that's the way they think. They only can see that leader. Take him down. Ya akhi, what's going to come with that? What is going to come with that? They don't look at it. And those same people have the audacity to talk about masalih and mafasid. That this is a maslaha and this is a mafsada. That the masalih have to be mura'at al-masalih wa mura'at al-mafasid. That what mafsada is greater than the whole of the Muslim people living under anarchy. وَلِذَلِكَ عَلِي بْنَ أَبِي طَالِبٍ said a very powerful statement as well. He said, أَمِيرٌ غَشُومٌ خَيْرٌ مِّن فِتْنَةٍ تَدُومٌ. Ali ibn Abi Talib said, 40 years of a tyrant leader who is deceitful and treacherous, a tyrant leader for 40 years is better than one day without a leader. In another wording he said, a evil leader to be in place is better than a continuous fitna. That's the truth of Allah. One day without a leader and 40 years under a tyrant leader, it's better 40 years of under a tyrant leader. هذا السلف وهذه الأمة. That's what they said.